In this week, we have learned about the working principles and energy potential of a number of renewable energy technologies. In this video, we will compare these technologies. As we have learned so far, most of our used energy is directly or indirectly powered by the sun. Solar irradiation incident on Earth can be directly converted by photovoltaic technologies or solar thermal technologies. The energy from the sun can also be used indirectly. Solar radiation causes temperature and pressure differences in the atmosphere, which is the source for wind power. The wind itself can also be used indirectly in the form of ocean wave. Additionally, sunlight evaporates the water that eventually precipitates in a location with a greater height. The resulting water mass at that height has potential energy that can be converted into electricity with hydropower. Finally, plants used for biofuels convert the energy from solar irradiation into chemical energy. However, we have also discussed renewable energy technologies that do not use the sun as its primary source, such as geothermal and tidal energy conversion technologies. Geothermal energy originates from the Earth's core and crust. Subsequently, the tides are caused by the gravitational pull of the moon and the sun. Let's take a look at the world map that we have used at the end of each of this week's lectures. As a reminder, the blocks represent the area that each technology requires to meet the world's electricity demand in 2040. This map is therefore an indication of the power output density of renewable technologies. We can gather from this map the photovoltaic energy conversion has the largest power output density. Furthermore, since most renewable energy sources are a derivative of solar energy, their available energy potential is fundamentally less as indicated by this figure. We can also see that the available power potential of some technologies like tidal, geothermal or hydropower is insufficient to meet the electricity demand in 2015. Then, why don't we use all our resources to improve the efficiency of solar panels to a degree that we can harvest most of its energy? Well, there is a good reason. To start, locally the sun does not provide a constant magnitude of energy. In summer, there is more sunlight than in winter. Fortunately, with wind energy, it is the other way around, as it provides more energy during winter than in summertime. However, due to the intermittent character of these technologies, they are not a stable source. Moreover, there is a possibility that demand surpasses production. Batteries like the ones in electric cars can provide a solution. However, due to the high material demand, relatively high cost and weight, relatively short lifetime, and inability to supply seasonal storage of the current technology, it is not an ideal solution. Stable continuous sources like geothermal and hydropower can provide a base load for the grid. Moreover, geothermal technology can supply seasonal heat storage and reservoirs in hydro and tidal power plants can be filled when the production surpasses demand. These technologies therefore provide energy storage capability, albeit limited. Biomass power plants can also provide a stable source of electrical energy. In addition, biofuels can be easily transported and used as a renewable alternative in conventional fossil fuel technologies. Of course, there are other criteria than the power output density and available power potential for comparing renewable technologies. The impact on the environment and the cost per unit power are also very important factors. A popular way of expressing the environmental impact is with the carbon footprint. The carbon footprint indicates the amount of carbon released per unit energy over the system's lifetime. First of all, let's gain some perspective by looking at the carbon footprint of coal-fired power plants. This is 820 grams carbon dioxide per kilowatt hour. On average, the carbon footprint of a hydroelectricity is typically 24 grams carbon dioxide per kilowatt hour. According to the IPCC research from 2014, wind power has a much smaller carbon footprint. The average footprint over the entire lifetime of a wind turbine is 11 grams CO2 per kilowatt hour for onshore wind and 12 grams for offshore projects. Notably, PV technology has a larger carbon footprint. This is caused by the fairly energy-intensive processing of the silicon semiconductor material. According to the IPCC research from 2014, on average, the carbon footprint of large-scale PV installations is about 48 grams carbon dioxide per kilowatt hour of generated energy. Geothermal energy has a footprint of 89.4 CO2 per kilowatt hour. Finally, biomass has the largest carbon emissions since greenhouse gases are emitted during the burning of biomass. The carbon footprint of biomass power plant is 230 grams carbon dioxide per kilowatt hour. As a concluding note, the carbon emissions of each of these technologies, individual projects, depend on the circumstances. In countries with high solar irradiation, the carbon footprint of PV systems can be much smaller than indicated here. Furthermore, the carbon footprint of biofuels has a very wide range. This is because of the big difference in the sources and processing. Therefore, the carbon footprint of biomass power plants can be as high as that of all processing. Then, perhaps the most important criteria for the wide-scale implementation of renewable energy is the cost per unit power. To compare this cost, the levelized cost of electricity, or LCOE, is generally used. The levelized cost of electricity is an economic assessment of the average total cost to build and operate a power-generating system divided by the total energy output of the system over its entire lifetime. First, let's take a look at the levelized cost of electricity of natural gas-fired power plant and a coal power plant. The levelized cost of electricity of these technologies is generally around 6 to 7 cents per kilowatt hour, but it can vary quite significantly. A substantial part of these costs are its fuel costs. Now we can compare to our renewable technologies. We introduce hydropower, biomass and geothermal, which can all provide a continuous energy source like fossil fuels. Both hydropower and geothermal power plants can potentially outperform conventional power plants under the right conditions. Finally, the intermittent sources. Photovoltaic energy and wind energy can be significantly cheaper than fossil fuel plants. Moreover, while fossil fuels will get more expensive in the near future, developments in renewable energy technologies will only make these sources cheaper. Currently, developments occur so fast that the data from this 2070 US Energy Information Agency will most likely be outdated in 2 years' time. It should be clear by now that the renewable energy infrastructure of the future will consist of a mixture of different technologies. The exact mix will very much be location dependent. This week, I have provided you with simple tools to calculate the potential of various energy sources. At the end of this week, I challenge you to do these calculations for your country. I hope this exercise will provide you more insights in the challenges we face in becoming less dependent on fossil fuels.